What I want to do today is actually going to be sharing a segment out of the last chapter of the Tree of Life Realities, Melchizedek, Volume 2, that I've been writing. It's only, this segment is just two paragraphs, basically expanded for the sake of the message today. But when PK asked me to speak on Easter Sunday, and we kind of went through how many messages we've already talked about, crucifixion, death, resurrection, crucifixion, and all that sort of stuff, all these different things. So I wanted to take that from a slightly different angle if I can today. And that's what this is called, Resurrection Wake Up, awakening to the realization you're not dead anymore. I am more convinced than ever that the gospel of Jesus Christ isn't just about the story of Jesus, nor his miracles or his passion, the crucifixion and resurrection, which all are important, but more so, the central truth of the gospel of Christ is God himself unveiled within us.
Yes.
That's the key.
Amen.
It's about the reality of eternal life, our eternal soul, the never-ending life of God within us, the tree of life, emanated and revealed through each one of us with no exceptions. The idea that Jesus rose from the dead wasn't because he was killed and then some uncanny miracle of eternal life occurred. Rather, instead of just proving he was the special anointed one, it was that he always was eternal life. And there was nothing in this cosmos of egoistic illusion that could destroy, kill, or end that life. Jesus. Egoistic man tried to crucify and bury it, but to no avail.
No. Wow.
Nothing you can do, or anyone else can do, or anyone else may have tried to do to you or themselves. Call it abuse, call it sin, call it violence, call it self-condemnation, it doesn't matter. You cannot destroy, kill, or end the reality that you were and are created in the image and likeness of God, which means the eternal life of God is not just within you, it is you. Jesus then says this in the Gospel of Luke, the 17th chapter. We've heard this before, but I want to go over it one more time. Now when he was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, he answered them and said, "The kingdom of God does not come with observation, nor will they say, 'See here or see there.' For indeed, the kingdom of God is within you."
Yes.
The ultimate point that Jesus was making was something so profound at the time that if we today, right now, grasp that truth, it changes how we understand ourselves and how we read everything in the Bible. The kingdom of God isn't in the external world.
No.
The kingdom of God is in the eternal world. And that world is so real, the egoistic eyes of the flesh and of blood cannot see it. It is within you. But if we grasp that it's really within us and awaken to what that means, it changes not only what we think about God and his kingdom, but it also changes how we view ourselves. Think of it. When Jesus said this, he wasn't talking to people who said a sinner's prayer. Listen to that. Nor believed that he died on a cross and rose from the grave, and believed they had to receive him into their hearts, all of which was inapplicable at this point.
That's right.
No. He was speaking to who? The Pharisees.
Wow.
And he's telling them, the Pharisees, the kingdom of God is within you.
Wow.
So the least likely, the kingdom of God is within you. If you realize that regardless of whatever condition you are in, emotionally, mentally, physically, even religiously, the kingdom of God is within you, and that's the way it is, you can't undo that.
Thank you, Jesus.
Everything changes because now it's not something separate from you. To make the point even further, when you get it, this idea, the Greek word that's used there, which is entos, for within, doesn't even need to be there. Oh. Ultimately, the kingdom of God is you. What did it mean to heal the blind? This is more than just causing someone who couldn't see their own hand in front of their face to be able to see. But it's being able to see divine reality as it truly is. This is what we're calling resurrection wake up.
Good job.
It's realizing you're not dead.
Hallelujah.
You never were. Death, or as some have termed it, as separation from God, is an egoistic religious illusion created by our believing what the serpent said when we partook of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If for a moment we think that our thoughts and actions, presumed independent from God, can change what he's established, then we way overestimate ourselves. Of course, our fleshly ego believes that. And for that matter, it underestimates the creator of all life. While he gives us the choice to see reality as it is, or sleep, another biblical word for death, dreaming that we were either not like God enough, not good enough, need to know the difference between good and evil to become like God, or just throw the towel in and say, I can't see God, so it must not exist. We think way too much of ourselves. In the name of resurrected life, and it's within each of us, I want to share with you a parable of Jesus. Understand something before we begin. Awakening to a Christ reality, and like Jesus, living from the world above. If you remember in the Gospel of John, he says, I'm from above, you're from below.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
Even though he's standing right there.
Right.
So he's not talking about physical world.
No.
He's talking about a mindset.
Right.
He's talking about a way of seeing. This can only be done from a totally different consciousness, a completely different way of thinking. The Apostle Paul calls it the mind of Christ, 1 Corinthians 2:16. The more we move away from a serpentine binary world of good and evil to a more liberated world of divine life, the more we unveil our true identity as his kingdom and live from that likeness. However, it seems to be a tough pill to swallow that the world below in which we seemingly live is nothing more than the good and evil stories we tell ourselves about our experiences and the illusions we fabricate from their memory about what's facing us right now. The incarnation of Christ, Emmanuel, God with us, God in mankind, wasn't about validating this egoistic world of flesh and blood. The Apostle Paul was clear. Now I say this, brethren, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Right? 1 Corinthians 15:50. Nonetheless, on the heels of connecting the realm of flesh and blood as corrupt, or as some translate, the natural body with the egoistic base nature, in Greek it's called soma, see if I say the next word right, soma psukikon. That's in 1 Corinthians 15:44. It's the egoistic base nature. Paul equates that to death. In other words, death isn't what happens when the physical body ceases to exist, but when we exist in the serpentine system of ego, the self-centeredness, that religious literalism and legalism we espouse for self-gratifying passions, or even without all that, self-gratifying passions where we abuse others so we can feel some kind of temporal satisfaction. add to that the good and evil morality we fabricate with the inevitable accusation of ourselves or others, you could say, welcome to the dream world of the Night of the Living Dead. While Paul does declare in Isaiah 25:8 scripture, death is swallowed up in victory, he doesn't stop with a mere promise of some kind of heavenly afterlife or us receiving another incorruptible body at some time in the future. Rather, he gives us further definition by establishing the source of this corruption and how this thing called death has the ability to pierce us terminally. Now, I wanted to make the point because what he's referring to is 1 Corinthians 15:56. Now, I blurred out the guy's face because whether you knew him or not was not the point. I want you to understand, because this was connected to a video. He says, the sting of death is sin. Just get that in your head for a minute, because it's an incomplete verse. The video goes on for several minutes talking about sin is the problem, and that's what's bringing death into our lives. But that's not what Paul says. What Paul says is this: the sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. You want to get rid of the problem? Get rid of the law. It neutralizes the egoistic self, because then the ego doesn't have anything to sink its teeth into except selfishness. And then as soon as we become aware of that, that's how we start to unveil the reality of Christ in us, because that's a fake us. The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. 1 Corinthians 15:56. That's the NIV version. By naming the law as the infectious agent that empowers sin, making it a venomous toxin, he points us right to the definition of death that God gave regarding the tree of knowledge of good and evil in Genesis chapter 2, verse 17. With that in mind, consider this: same apostle, different epistle. When you were dead, consider that, in your sins and the uncircumcision of your sinful nature, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins. How did he do that? What does that mean? Right. Having canceled the written code with its regulations that was against us and that stood opposed to us. He took it away, nailing it to the cross. Yeah, just stop and soak that in for a minute. With that in mind, if the legalism of decreeing what is good and evil is nailed to the cross of Christ, Colossians 2:14, what then does the incarnation reveal before and after the cross? It's the conclusive apocalypse of all religious injunctions, along with its bedfellow of political connection and dominance. It declares we're no longer subject to those jurisdictions and reveals them for what they are. Quote, again, the Apostle Paul, the weak and worthless elementary principles of the world, Galatians 4:9. There's the serpentine nature wants to hold on to that law code thing so bad, because if it doesn't and it lets it go, it begins to die. You can't kill the ego by holding on to what's right and wrong. Sounds nuts, but that's why it's a different world. I love this picture. I wish I knew who developed it. It's really good. It's communicating to us how we tend to try and live up to a standard within our own minds that we can't attain.
Wow, that's good. Wow.
This is what religion, not to mention religious fundamentalism, fuels. It then adds, but it's okay. Jesus will help you or even do it for you. You're not capable. And the lie continues. Think of the message, miracles, and life of Jesus. He didn't have authority simply because he was special or really good or more holy or more powerful than the opposition was evil or demonic. It wasn't even because he held the title of Messiah and had a unique endowment from the Spirit, though both are true. No. It's because he wasn't part of a kingdom that was antagonistic to itself. I'll say that again. He wasn't part of a kingdom that was antagonistic to itself. Consider the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the system of death. It's a system that opposes itself. Its accuser accuses itself. In other words, evil accuses good of being evil, and good accuses evil of being evil. In other words, I'll say it again. Evil accuses good of being evil, and good accuses evil of being evil. It opposes itself. Hence, a very interesting verse of scripture that I want to share with you, because both stand with their fingers pointed at each other, in opposition to themselves, and yet, supposedly, they're a united kingdom. Nothing, no reference to England there and Ireland.
No,
and everything.
No.
In the end, its own ruin and destruction prevails. It can't stand. The incarnation was and is its eschaton. It's end times. You want to know about the end times coming and all these other things? It started the day Jesus showed up.
That's right.
At that moment, the end came. We're now just starting to figure it all out. Jesus didn't gain victory over death at the resurrection. He had the victory over it long before he was even conceived in Mary's womb. The resurrection 3 days after the crucifixion is just the eminent proof of what always was true. Divine life. It's reality. Anything else is an illusion. So, as Jesus said, watch this. So he called them to himself and said to them in parables, how can Satan cast out Satan? As a side note, they just accused him of being Beelzebub.
Right.
Okay? Because he healed a blind man.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, as if that was a bad thing. So he called them to himself and said to them in parables, how can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan is risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but has an end. No one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man, and then he will plunder his house. Assuredly, I say to you, all sins will be forgiven the sons of men, and whatever blasphemies they utter. But he who blasphemes the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is subject to eternal damnation, because they said he has an unclean spirit. Did I say condemnation or damnation? Eternal condemnation. I apologize. The serpent and its tree, springing forth with all its illusions of literalism and legalism, is a kingdom that's divided against itself. It cannot stand against what's real. While Jesus was responding to the scribes and Pharisees because they called him Beelzebub, the ruler of demons, Lord of the flies, actually, literally, Lord of the dunghill, you can figure that one out. And all this because he healed a blind man. He makes the point that their rationalization doesn't work. At the same time, he wasn't saying that Beelzebub's kingdom was undivided and strong. How many times we've misread this?
Right.
And we come barreling in. I bind you, devil. I got more power than you do. Sorry. First of all, the whole notion of binding, I think I shared this in Oregon. When it says whatever you bind on earth, because we start binding devils, it means to be married to. Why do you want to be married to the devil? Assuming you believe in that kind of devil anyway. He wasn't saying Beelzebub's kingdom was undivided and strong, nor was he saying that he can do what he did because he's God and is much stronger. Just for the sake of talking, Jesus didn't come in a blue suit with red boots and a red cape with an S for Savior on his chest. Rather, the strong man in the parable isn't strong at all. There isn't even a strong man guarding the house. Rather, there's a divided ruler opposing himself and who's easily vanquished because of it. Why? By virtue of the by virtue of being divided, he creates his own end. Right? His kingdom cannot stand. Thus, Jesus tells his accusers that they are divided against themselves, calling the Holy Spirit unclean, and by virtue of their own law, Leviticus 24, 16, it condemns them. In Luke's account, in Luke 11, 14 to 23, it adds that the strong man was fully armed, but with what? Based on how Jesus ends the discussion, their armament was nothing more than the attractive legalistic trimmings of an empty religion. The so-called guardians of the house are at most accusers of a blind man charging why he should remain blind, and accusers of Jesus concocting why he really didn't have the right to do what he did. In their empowered ego, they've bound themselves by violating the very religious law they attempted to defend and blaspheme the Holy Spirit in an attempt to guard its purity. What made Jesus the stronger one who could enter their house and plunder their goods? It was the so-called guardians were already bound without Jesus having to lift a finger. Christ was of a different house, a different kingdom, where there's no conflict of right and wrong, good and evil, accuser and accused. In his kingdom, there's only the steadfast immovability of resting in the loving compassion of grace and life. So Jesus just waltzes into the house, the guardians are already bound by their own doing, and takes their goods. In other words, he heals the blind, both physically and most importantly spiritually, who are captivated by a paper tiger religious system. Another way of saying this is Jesus is reality, who, like an apocalypse morning light, awoke people from the illusion of what kept them asleep. In Christ, in the truest sense, is the apocalypse. It's not about an end of the world in some horrific sense, but the end of the egoistic fleshly self and awaking to the reality of God among and within you. Of course, the ego will scream, its destruction, its fiery end has come. But that's how that kingdom thinks. I want to take you back for a second to a message I did called The Returns from a while ago. Like our example in The Wizard of Oz that we used some time ago, just to remind you, if you remember the short version today of the story, is that, well, I got more to go, so I don't want to tell the whole story. But the short version is, it begins, of course, in the movie. It's black and white, right, to make a point. And the wonderful song, Somewhere Over the Rainbow, Where Skies Are Blue, really is Dorothy desiring something other than what she has. And little Toto is a real good symbol of her ego. Because what winds up happening is Toto keeps eating Mrs. Gulch's flowers. So the real enemy here is not Miss Gulch, but Dorothy's unwillingness to correct the dog. Because she doesn't stop him. And because she doesn't stop him, that's what gets Mrs. Gulch all fired up. So Mrs. Gulch comes out into the garden and Toto bites her. Mm-hmm. According to the actual story, when she came with that letter from the police to take the dog, she was talking about taking the dog to be euthanized. Yeah. Why? It bitter.
Right.
That should tell us something about when we start thinking about skies are blue in other places and we don't realize the beauty of what we had. And eventually what happens, she takes the dog. The dog, of course, jumps out of the little basket on the back of the bicycle and comes back to Dorothy. Dorothy decides to leave. When she leaves, she meets Mr. Marvel, who is basically a charlatan type of guy with a nice heart, but, you know,
right.
Still not. No marvel whatsoever.
Right.
Okay, and he persuades her to go back home. She goes back home. As she's going home, the tornado happens, right? And then by the time she gets there, her family's gone. They went into a storm shelter.
Right.
And she runs into the house, gets hit on the head by a frame in her bedroom,
yeah.
And all of a sudden gets actually knocked out, but the way the movie and the book have it is she actually gets knocked over for a second, and she just looks through the window, and the house is caught up in the tornado. Keep in mind that the Wicked Witch of the East, who the house is about to fall on in Oz, is, by her lineage and definition, she's the one who creates tornadoes.
Right.
Keep in mind, Dorothy is Dorothy Gale.
Right.
Dorothy is the Wicked Witch of the East.
Right.
That's why the ruby slippers are transferred to her feet. Well, in the book, it's silver slippers. But anyway, the point is then she goes through Oz. She arrives in Oz, and we watch literally through the window Mrs. Gulch riding on a bicycle turning into the Wicked Witch of the West.
Right.
This is all her dream world now. This is her illusion, but it's real to her.
Right.
That's the point.
Right.
So she goes through Oz with all the stories of follow the yellow brick road and meeting her three friends, and won't get into all that. But she goes into all this and she fights the Wicked Witch of the West, and there's flying monkeys like principalities and powers.
Right.
And there's, you know, falling asleep in the poppy field.
Right.
There's trees that throw apples at her because she was hungry and picked one. On and on and on it goes.
Yeah.
All for the sake of finding a wizard who could rescue her and take her home. And in the end game, what do we find out? The wizard's got no power either.
Right.
Think that through.
Yeah.
Even the vanquishing of the Wicked Witch of the West was an accident.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't do it on purpose.
Right.
I mean, there's a beautiful evolving of the story that creates that. But the point is this all leads to the very end, that scene.
Mm-hmm.
And if you watch carefully, by the way, in the video, the movie, if you remember, the Wizard of Oz, a.k.a. Mr. Marvel, is in the what do you call it?
The hot air balloon.
Right, thank you. He's in the hot air balloon, and Dorothy gets in it, and it's Toto that sees a Siamese cat. He jumps out and goes after the cat, which gets Dorothy out of there. And then if you watch carefully, the Tin Man walks over and looses the rope, and that's what lets the hot air balloon go. So now she's technically, you would think, stuck. But the idea was totally neutralizing even the belief of a grand old wizard. How about the big bad god that's outside of you that's going to grant your requests? And she's got to be told in the end that you've always had this power.
Yeah.
It's always been there.
Mm-hmm.
To the Pharisee, the kingdom is in you.
Yes.
To all of us, the kingdom is you.
Yeah.
His divine life is there. Eventually, Dorothy is trapped in that land. But how does she vanquish, truly, the witches, the monkeys, the Winky Guards? That's what they're called, by the way, Winky Guards. They were defeated not because Dorothy had the more powerful ruby slippers. She didn't even use them. She didn't know what that was.
Right.
Point being is, she didn't defeat her foes because if she had some power that she utilized like the ruby slippers or the silver slippers. Nor did she find her way home because she found the path to the great and powerful wizard who had the magic to take her there. No. Her foes were vanquished, and she found a way home because of why. She woke up.
Mm-hmm.
She woke up. The moment she became aware of reality, not the story and dream and illusion she created. Great story, great dream. I mean, it's a great movie. I still love it.
Oh, yeah.
Guess what happens when she woke up? The same is true with us. There's no witches. There's no flying monkeys. There's no wizards to be found. Hence, there's no demons. There's no sin. There's no hell and the like. It wasn't that Jesus had more power or was even more holy, but that in Jesus' world, the world above, that stuff doesn't exist. In Jesus' world or the tree of life, I want you to consider the following. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven you." Mm-hmm. Now keep in mind what I just read to you before.
Right.
This is just less than a chapter earlier.
Okay.
Almost a full chapter earlier. So these thoughts are still all riding together. Jesus saw their faith and said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven you." And some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts. In the Luke account, it says scribes and Pharisees were reasoning in their hearts, "Why does this man speak blasphemies like this? Who can forgive sins but God alone?" But immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they reasoned thus within themselves, he said to them, "Why do you reason about these things in your hearts? Which is easier? To say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven you,' or to say, 'Arise, take up your bed and walk.' But that you may know that the Son of Man," pause, "has power on earth to forgive sins," he said to the paralytic, "I say to you, arise, take up your bed, and go to your house." Immediately he rose, took up his bed, went out in the presence of them all, so that all were amazed and glorified God, saying, "We never saw anything like this." The key to the paralysis of the man on the stretcher being healed wasn't Jesus laying his hands on him and commanding or speaking to his body or some strong demon that had him bound. Rather, Jesus goes to the root of the problem, which is, "Son, your sins are forgiven you." Wait, what? What about an appropriate blood sacrifice or of a goat or something? What about some form of penance? Nope, nothing. Just, regardless of what you believe, you're not a sinner anymore. Immediately, the literalist, legalist were conflicted. Just as anyone by the illusion of the tree of knowledge of good and evil would be. Their house is divided. To them, Jesus was blaspheming, saying that this man's sins were forgiven as if he were God. However, Jesus didn't see their laws as binding to him, nor dictating what he could or could not say or do. That wasn't his world.
Right.
To Jesus, neither the law of sin, Romans 8, neither the law of sin nor the paralysis it caused meant anything of value. Reality has shown up, and their illusion of rules and ritual couldn't do anything about it. Then, as only Jesus can do, he calls their legalistic bluff, right? Just like a poker game. Mm-hmm. He calls their bluff saying, "I see your bet and I raise you a stretcher."
Oh, wow.
Consider this. Rather than responding within the confines of their belief system, which said only God can forgive sins, Jesus says this, "that you may know the Son of Man."
That's right.
Not even saying Son of God. Son of Man, which has a very specific meaning, has the power on earth to forgive sins. Hence, another apocalypse happens. He says to the paralytic, "Arise, take up your bed and go to your house." In other words, reality is here, and the illusions that said you were a sinner that would keep you bound are irrelevant in my world. The difference between only God can forgive sins and that you may know the Son of Man has authority is that their God wouldn't forgive without a payoff. Give me some blood, a sacrifice or something, and if it's acceptable, I'll consider it. But Jesus comes from a reality where he and his Father wasn't offended to begin with. The notion of the Son of Man, which some believe is a messianic reference, Jesus is saying, in my world, I think tree of life thoughts, and all mankind can just get up and come home like the prodigal. Whew. As far as the messianic reference, the Messiah is simply a person who knows their divine identity and functioning according to that divine design. In other words, Jesus was truly being human. The only difference between Jesus and us would be this. This is a great quote from 1976 by a woman by the name of Helen Schuchman, A Course in Miracles. Quote, "There is nothing about me that you can't attain," Jesus speaking. "I have nothing that does not come from God. The only difference between us now is that I have nothing else. This leaves me in a state which is only potential in you." That's an interesting way of putting it. What was Jesus revealing in Mark 2 and 3? What was all that really about? He lives in reality. We don't. But we can choose to. Reality is where Christ exists. Anything other than that is an illusion created by our egoistic self. Originally, God and Adam, us, created together. God brought an emanation of life. Now, I know the Bible translated beasts, but the word behemoth, which is beasts, is not there in Hebrew. It's the word chaya, life force. Okay? He created the life force, and we, Adam, gave it definition. Whatever the man called it, the Adam called it, that's what it was. That's Genesis 2:19, if anybody's interested. When we partook of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, we decided to redefine creation. Consider, in our world of illusion, and I keep using that word, I'll tell you why in a minute. If there's a house and we walk into a wall, we possibly get a nosebleed. However, in Jesus' world of reality, Luke 24, 36 through 7, John 20, 19, walls and locked doors are irrelevant. Which is kind of interesting to me, because this is the irony of Revelation 3:20. It says that Jesus stands at the door of our life and knocks. Why? Especially if the kingdom of God is you.
Right.
Because in the religious world we built, God is out and we're in. We choose to believe we're apart from God, spiritually dead in our sins, trying to seek a way back to God. But it's resurrection wake-up time. You're not dead. Mark chapter 5, verse 39. We've just been sleeping. Wow. If we just take Jesus' words to heart that the kingdom of God is in you and within you, he isn't standing at the door on the outside knocking. He's inside the house with us and knocking. Wow. Keep that focused. This doesn't change. Even in your most pharisaical day. Mm-hmm. Keep in mind, it was the Pharisees that will set Jesus up to be crucified. Mm-hmm. It still didn't change that. Mm-hmm. If he's inside the house, consider this. This is what the Apostle Paul reads here. In 2 Corinthians 4:18, "So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary." I'll tell you about the Greek word in a minute. "But what is unseen is eternal." Now, the Apostle Paul uses this word, proskaria. It has its root in the word kairos. Proskaros. Okay? Well, it's actually prokaryotes. It's conjugated. And what that means is not so much temporary like we would think, well, temporary is if it lasts 3 days. It's more of this ethereal, flitting idea of, because especially because the word kairos, you've all heard about a kairos moment compared to a chronos moment. Okay, well, this is pros kairos. In other words, it's only there if you want it to be.
Right.
And he's telling us we have a choice to look at the eternal, which is reality, or the thing we created, which really isn't. It cannot withstand the eternal, the real. If God didn't create it, it's not lasting and therefore not real. If God didn't create, the last we did is God gave life force, we gave it definition. Then we decided to go do something else. We're calling it everything else, right, wrong, good and evil, all this stuff. And guess what? God didn't create any of that. That's why it's temporal. I mean, if you want to expand into thinking, just to use the analogies the Bible gives us, well, it talks about a new heaven and new earth, talks about a new Jerusalem, the old one. Oh, why all that? Most of those of these metaphors trying to produce in us the thinking of what reality is. Whatever we think this is, it is not
right.
Real.
Right.
By God's definition. The only thing that is real in God's economy is whatever it lasts forever. If it doesn't last forever, it's not real. Now, real is the fancy word for English, our English definition of truth. Right. But I'm intentionally not using truth because truth gets really packed into things like facts and what isn't facts and all that stuff. When truth, aletheia in Greek, means that which is unveiled. Now it's the real. We were designed to be co-creators with God, not misusing our ability to define creation egoistically. But when we do that, which is what we have done, and many times perpetuate, we're living like dead men walking. It's time to awaken to the realization you're not dead anymore. The resurrection wake-up call is we can be whoever we really are, the way God designed you, and you are reality going somewhere to happen. The kingdom of God is you, and it supersedes everything else. I know for myself, the more I'm aware of it, the more miracles start happening in my life. And the greatest miracle is here. The next time you investigate the Bible, see it with God's eyes. See it with God's eyes that you and He are one, and His kingdom was always and will always be within you. All the parts of the scriptures that speak to that reality is not just Jesus' story, but your story. Your story. The Bible is your story. Jesus was just the firstborn amongst all the rest. He was the initiator, John 1, and he's the conclusion. How is that? The problem is many times we still externalize it. We take Jesus and put him out there. And he keeps telling, no, it's in here. It's here. No, Jesus, you're out there. That's why when I raise my hands to worship you, I'm looking outward. How many times we've done that?
Right.
When raising the hands have a whole different meaning in Hebrew, all that idea of what it means to do that if I'm really raising my hands, I'm recognizing Christ within me. I'm recognizing kingdom within me. And then I can't help it. But if I see it in me, I have to see it in you.
Amen.
Have to.
Yes.
Well, what if he's a Pharisee or he's Pontius Pilate or whatever? Pick some other religion, a political party.
Yeah.
Still in them, whether they know it or not. If I'm going to be fair to the scriptures and not chop them up and say, well, what about this one? What about that one? Half the time, honest, it's the way we've translated stuff. Or the choice to use a particular Greek text that maybe is a little bit different than the older ones because it matched a theology. Remember, next time you pick up your Bible, the tool. Remember, you're a Christ-centered person using the Bible as a tool. Not using the Bible. You're not a Bible-centered person hoping and assuming Christ will be a result, because that's not going to happen.
No.
We've proved that way too much already. But as a Christ-centered person, pick up the tool, and guess what? It now becomes your story. The fact that Jesus is the Son of the Father, he's saying, so are you. Well, I don't feel like the Son today. Who cares? It's your story. It's your story that you are a revelation of God going somewhere to happen. It's your story that you can actually live from the world above, which is true reality, and supersede anything this lower world has. And I got news for you. When we step away from that binary world of true knowledge of good and evil, all the judgment that goes with it and all that stuff, it's amazing the peace you have. Because you're not spending so much time judging others, let alone yourself.
Amen. Amen.
The only thing I want to focus on then, if I'm in that place, is what does life look like? What does love look like? What does that look like without that binary trapped world of illusion where my version of love is telling people how sinful they are? Try again. Remember Jesus' answer. You're not a sinner anymore. You don't have to be paralyzed by that stuff anymore. Take up your stretcher, walk. Go for it. And I do it as Son of Man.
Yes.
I do it as Son of Anthropos in Greek. I do it as a human being who's discovered the higher world. And Jesus Christ was totally aware of the higher world. Father, I pray that this Easter celebration, I pray, Lord, what it does is not only focuses on the resurrection of Christ, which totally undoes anything that put him on the cross, but that we realize that we are resurrected too. We have the same eternal life that the Christ has. And the message of the kingdom is, regardless of where you are in life, regardless of what you do, it's in you. And there is a way of life that transcends this one. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you very much.